No, this is for SG and the keynote speaker. Yes, sir. You're taking it.
I told you. No, I lost you.
You want me to move something?
Yeah. I think we should check Ahmed because he's tall.
Yeah, he's there. You stand there?
No.
You just give him the measure, huh?
Maybe it's because it's late. Yeah, it's late. This is fine.
But that means, you know, if Ahmed's sitting there...
No, can we...
Let's look at more.
Can we take it? This is maybe late. This is the one.
Yeah, this is late, but it's not late, it's wider. No, but that...
You shouldn't be
afraid.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, like if you're not having it right now, like life or not, like
yeah, okay.
Yeah, depends on what you play.
Okay. But he's there. Yes, he is there. We need to move it a little bit from the left. Yeah.
Okay. We can just take it a little bit to the left and then we're... Where? Yeah.
Okay.
Let me make sure I see. Perfect. Yeah, do this.
Yeah, I got it.
That's what you want to show for the carriage.
Yeah, but someone cut next. Yeah.
vector de zero.
Dear friends in Scouting, we are here today to celebrate all of you, our Messengers of Peace heroes. This, as you know, is an annual event where we recognize our Scout heroes for their outstanding contributions to community development, volunteering, and contributing to the culture of peace. I am honored to be here amongst all of you. We have a live audience joining us from around the world, so you can say hi to your friends and family. Hashtag Scout Heroes. We're trending on Twitter already. The program for today, as you know, will be to hear from you. You all have amazing stories. You have all done inspiring things in your community, and we want to hear directly from you. So we will start with some presentations. I will call your names one by one. You will take the stage, you will take the microphone, and you will have a 3-minute time period to tell your story. Following your speeches, we will have a keynote address from our special guest, who is stuck in the infamous Kuala Lumpur traffic. On their way, we will follow that with a presentation from the Secretary General of the World Organization of the Scout Movement, who will present to you your Messengers of Peace Hero Awards. After that, we will have a small discussion with the Secretary General to learn more about your challenges, to learn more about your successes, to learn more about how we can strengthen the network and strengthen Messengers of Peace. After that, we will have a small reception, official photograph, and then we'll spend some time together visiting Kuala Lumpur. Yeah. So now that I have broken the ice, and I've warmed you up, and nobody's nervous anymore, because we're all professional speakers, I would like to call on Miss Oana to start the show. Yeah.
I'm Anna. In order to start, I would ask you to do a very small exercise with me. Just close your eyes. And just relax. Take a deep breath in. Focus on the now. Feel the energy flowing in your body. Imagine how your outline just disappears and the illusion of separation disappears as well. You can feel that you're light. You are light as light. And you connect to the people in the room. You share your light. Soak in the sun. And dim the outside noise. You may now open your eyes. I hope you can feel the wave of energy going through this room. Well, to put it shortly, my project was about creating a space, an open space, where people could open their minds and their hearts to who they are, to letting go of perceptions, or better yet, understanding their perceptions and the way in which those perceptions interact with each other. I created and coordinated the diversity area during the Romanian Jamboree that we had this summer. Because yes, I forgot to mention this. I'm Anna Nitruțin, I'm from Romania, 25 years old. So during this project, I learned that it's very important to allow yourself to occupy the space that you want for yourself. And in order to do that, you need to be the creator of that space. And you also have to understand that you are co-creating with other people. And once you allow yourself to do that, you can also allow others to do that. I'm honored for being here. I'm honored that I get to share this spot with the other heroes. And I'm very happy that I got to warm this up for them because they have amazing stories and I'm humbled by their stories and I feel inspired. And more than that, I feel connected to every single person in this room because I've understood that we're all a big family and in each family, it's important to nurture the relationships. And it's important to share love and make sure that love flows constantly. So thank you for your amazing work. Thank you, everyone, for making it possible for me to be here today. And I am a proud scout, as all of you are. Thank you.
I'm proud to know Oana, to have visited her project in Romania, where they are, as scouts, breaking down cultural barriers, breaking down gender barriers, and making scouting open to all people. I'm also proud, as you are, of Oana for going first. Nobody likes to go first. She's made it easy for the rest of you. So you can thank her after the reception. I'd like to make a special note that Ms. Sarah Chen has joined us, and I will introduce her formally when she's about to provide her address. But she has joined us, and she will share some inspiring words with all of you. And our Secretary General has also joined us, and he will have the opportunity to address you after your speeches. So thank you, Oana, again for breaking the ice. Big round of applause for Oana. Next on my list, in one of our five official Wuzan languages, we will have a presentation on Espanol. Jessica de la Mexico, por favor.
22 años y soy mexicana.
Hello, my name is Jessica. I'm 22 years old and I'm Mexican.
Esto para México hoy en día significa atención, silencio y unidad.
This nowadays in Mexico represents attention, silence and unity.
Por lo que me gustaría pedir un minuto de silencio.
So I would like to ask you to take a minute of silence.
En memoria de las personas que perdieron la vida el pasado mes de septiembre en los sismos de México.
In memory of all the victims of the past earthquake in Mexico.
Mi proyecto se llama México de pie.
My project is Mexico Still Standing.
Y este se concentró en la zona más afectada de la Ciudad de México, la cual fue Xochimilco.
It was located in the most affected area of Mexico City, called or named Xochimilco.
Esta delegación no tuvo nada de apoyo.
This delegation has very few support during the earthquake.
Nosotros solicitamos el apoyo de gente rescatista, pero nunca llegó.
We support the help from the rescue crews, but it never arrived.
Así que tomamos las cartas y decidimos ayudar de la manera que fuera posible.
So scouts took over and we tried to help in the best way we could.
Me llena de orgullo decir que aunque no éramos expertos en el tema, pudimos rescatar 7 vidas.
We are very proud to say and report that even though we were not experts in rescue actions, we could save 7 lives.
Ha sido un trabajo muy difícil, cansado, pero lleno de esperanza.
It was a very exhausting job, very difficult, but it was full of hope.
No solo hemos coordinado centros de acopio, centros de salud y ayuda psicológica.
We not only coordinated the gathering centers, health centers, and psychologic help,
sino que hemos conjuntado trabajo junto con universidades y empresas privadas,
but we also coordinated work with universities and private sector
para poder conseguir el apoyo de material de reconstrucción.
So we could gather and collect the material for the reconstruction of some.
A la fecha llevamos 45 casas en construcción.
Today we can report that 45 houses are on progress.
Y esperamos que para febrero tengamos 119 ya construidas.
And we expect that for February 2018 we already have.
Estoy orgullosa de ser mexicana, de no quedarme sentada y hacer algo.
I'm very proud to be a Mexican and not being just waiting there, but that we did something.
Les puedo decir que México sigue de pie. Muchas gracias.
We can say that Mexico is still standing. Thank you.
Muchas gracias, mi amiga. I would like to now call on another one of our heroes who may be young, but he has the heart of a lion. His name is Leo.
Here with you on the MOP Hero Award Ceremony. And I would like to say thank you for all scouts who organized this event and for those who support me during my journey. So as already was said, I'm Leo and I'm from Kazakhstan. And the project that brought me here called a Youth Educational Program based on the values of national and scout. And you may ask me, why exactly youth program? So, and we have several reasons to do exactly youth program. And the first of all, youth is always open-minded. They are not so conservative as, for example, older people. And in Kazakhstan, you could see it very hard because, you know, during the 20th century, the Kazakhstan was a part of USSR. In the USSR, they have organization very similar to Scouts, and it was called Pioneering Organization. And it was very similar, but it has some difference. For example, very strong ideology and political systems. And now, if in Kazakhstan, you'll try to attract a people who is older than 30 years old, he will just think that you are trying to reborn the pioneering and just won't go there. Or, on another hand, if you will try to attract the people who is still older than 18 but under 30, he will just think like scouting. Scouts, is it children that sell cookies or something like that? This is really serious. So, and the other reason, it is the youth is now the still next generation. And so, today they are youth, tomorrow they will have their own children, and they will teach them how to be a good scouts. And all together, we will create a better world.
Maintenant, on va changer la langue française et j'aimerais présenter M. Safidi.
Ok. Hello everyone.
Hello.
My name is Safidi. I'm from Madagascar. Just. Qui as-tu? Tu peux me traduire maintenant. Donc, qui a des filles ou des femmes dans sa famille?
Is there anyone in this room who has women or girls in their family? Show of hands.
Okay. Je pense que vous avez des filles et des femmes, des femmes dans votre famille. Actuel à Madagascar, je lead un projet sur la gestion d'hygiène menstruelle.
Currently in Madagascar, I am managing a project about women and female menstrual hygiene.
Tout le monde disait que t'es fou, t'es un scout, t'es un boy scout, et tu parles de l'hygiène menstruelle.
People told me I was crazy. I'm a scout, I'm a boy. What do I know about female menstrual hygiene?
Mais je vais parler de la réalité qui se passe à Madagascar en ce moment.
I shared with them the reality that's taking place in Madagascar.
En ce moment, beaucoup de femmes et beaucoup de filles ne portent pas des culottes et des serviettes hygiéniques pendant sa menstruation.
The current situation in Madagascar is that many women do not have sanitary napkins to use during their menstrual cycle.
Donc, le sang coule sur ses cuisses et il n'y a pas quelque chose qui va recevoir le sang qui coule.
There is a challenge with maintaining the hygiene during this cycle.
Et beaucoup de gens aussi n'ont pas les moyens pour acheter des serviettes hygiéniques lavables pendant ces périodes-là.
Many people do not have the financial means to purchase the necessary hygienic equipment.
Et aussi, c'est tabou de parler ça entre femmes et famille. On ne peut pas parler entre hommes et femmes dans sa famille menstrual hygiene.
Normally, this is a private conversation that takes place within families, women to women. It is not normally the place of a man to have input in this conversation.
Donc, lors de l'atelier MOP de la région Afrique, on nous a inspiré que il faut faire la différence. Et j'ai pris une initiative de faire la différence que les Boy Scouts parlent de l'hygiène menstruelle.
Following a successful Messengers of Peace workshop in Madagascar, I was inspired. I was inspired to take action in my community, and I rallied the scouts in my group to take action on female menstrual hygiene.
Donc, quand j'étais retourné à Madagascar, on avait une formation sur la gestion d'hygiène menstruelle. J'étais le seul homme qui étaient là pendant cette formation.
When I went back to my city in Madagascar, there was a training on menstrual hygiene, and I was the only man in the room.
Et j'ai dit, je peux le faire. Je peux porter les voix des femmes et des filles.
I said to myself, I can do it. I can be the voice of girls and women in my community.
Donc, j'ai pris l'initiative de parler, et en ce moment, 30 000 scouts à Madagascar parlent de l'hygiène menstruelle.
I took the initiative, I started a project, and today I can say 30,000 scouts in Madagascar are trained in talking about female menstrual hygiene.
Donc, si je peux le faire, on peut le faire ensemble.
If I can do it, we can all do it together.
Donc, on va aider les filles et les femmes ensemble.
We will continue to help girls and women together.
We are scouts, we are messengers of peace.
Genital mutilation, they experience abortion, they are being married off at 9 years. It's really bad. And you, as me as a person, as a scout, who is educated, I want to see somebody else having that experience of education. And I'm proud because I'm not working alone, but with a team of girls who are standing strong as scouts to make sure that you're bringing up greater leaders, nation builders, as just those called the girl power. And in our group, we donate our sanitary towels, innerwear for the girls, to show them the appreciation that they are felt within the community. And as a scout, I say that every action we do to the community, it is counted for. Maybe somebody closer to you doesn't see it, but somebody somewhere sees it. So be an inspiration to someone. Make sure we embrace gender equality, and we create a better world. Thank you so much.
To the Spanish language, and I would like to invite a friend, Josue.
Buenas tardes a todos. Es un gusto para mí estar con todos ustedes.
I'm very proud to be
Para comenzar, cuando me llamaron y me dijeron, te vas a Malasia, vas a recibir este premio, yo no lo podía creer.
To start with, when I was called that I was going to Malaysia, you are going to receive a prize, it was really unbelievable for me.
Le dije a mi mamá, mamá, me voy a Malasia, y mi mamá me dijo, anda a comer.
I told my mom, mom, I'm going to Malaysia, and my mom said, like, just go do it.
Ha sido un viaje más de 12 horas. La verdad que no he podido dormir nada, pero el estar con ustedes me llena de. Estoy muy feliz.
It was a journey of more than 12 hours, but being here it makes me really, really.
Mi nombre es Josué Rivera, tengo 21 años de edad y soy de Perú.
My name is Josué Rivera, I'm 21 years old and I'm from Peru.
Les contaré un poco de mi proyecto. Ese se llama Operación Siempre Listo.
My project name is Always Ready.
Este comenzó cuando mi país fue sacudido con el fenómeno Niño Costero.
We started this project when my country was affected by the phenomenon of the El Niño Costero.
Arrebató más de 1 millón de casas y ganados.
The phenomenon affected more than 100 homes and it take cattle and farms.
Y era hora de que el gobierno de Perú y con los scouts se pongan de pie y ayudar.
And it was time that the government with the scouts get organized and could help the victims.
A nivel nacional, más de 280 jóvenes y extranjeros con la cual les doy un agradecimiento, pudimos solventar más de 15 toneladas de ayuda a estas personas.
Nationwide, more than 280 volunteers with the support also of foreign support, we could gather 15,000 tons of help and support for the victims.
Y a ellas les doy un agradecimiento especial.
And we are very grateful for them for all the support that they provided to us.
Estas donaciones repartidas en ropa, comida no perecible y etc.
So this material that we gathered, that we collected, is clothes, dry food, and medicine that the victims could use.
Ahorita el Perú está subiendo poco a poco, pero igual ha quedado una pequeña secuela.
At this moment of today, Peru is slowly getting back to its stand again, but still there are some areas affected.
Pero yo digo que a pesar de los problemas hay que ponernos de pie.
But I say that despite all the challenges, we have to stand up again.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias.
Gracias.
I would now like to call on one of our neighborhood friends, somebody who is very close to Malaysia, physically and in her heart. Miss Benny.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Thank you for the opportunity. I feel blessed to have you around with me today, and I feel more than happy to have you with me in this room. So my name is Benny. I am from Indonesia. But before I go to the core of my story, I would like to ask you one single question. And you can just simply answer with a yes or no, okay? Friends, are you messengers of peace?
Yes!
Thank you. Yes, we are messengers of peace. So as scouts, as messengers of peace, I believe that all of you are aware that every year there is one event that we always celebrate. Correct?
Yes.
Can anybody guess?
Yes.
What is it?
Peace Day.
Yes, exactly. The International Day of Peace, which we always celebrate every 21st of September. So friends, my story is about the International Day of Peace in my country, which we celebrate every year since 2014. So, at the beginning of 2014, there was a call of action from the World Scout Bureau, from Cynthia, and then I and my team sat together and we discussed to celebrate our very first International Day of Peace at that. 3 years ago. And at that time, we had 100 people celebrating with us for the peace day in Jakarta. And then next year we continue. 2015, we have 200 people celebrating with us. And the following year, we have 300 people. This year, we have 400 people. As you can see, friends, that might not be a big number. We don't have 1,000 scouts, 2,000 scouts celebrate with us. But for us, the most important thing is about the process. How can we always improve? How can we always manage? And how can we do something, even though it's very small, but can bring a meaning for others? So friends, I know all of us, each of us is busy with our life, with life inside and outside scouting, But at least, as messengers of peace, we always have one day to remember that we are all here for a reason. We are here to create a better world, and we are all in the network of peace. All right, friends, so from the celebration of International Day of Peace every year, we learn about the commitment, we learn about the consistency, and we also learn about teamwork. Now, we still have 7 to 8 months to prepare the National Day of Peace. So here, I would like to invite all of you guys to join for the next year celebration of the Peace Day. So we will be waiting for you. And we are Scouts, we are Messenger of Peace. Hand in hand, let's create a better world.
Thank you so much. I'm sure you've all marked that date on your calendar. Challenge issued. This will be the biggest International Day of Peace yet. We have 2 more speakers before we move to our keynote address. And we will have, following our ceremony, a reception. I don't know if there are donuts, but I do know that it is. So next speaker.
Hello, brothers and sisters in Scouting. My name is Elif and I'm from Turkey. I'm sure that you know the civil war that took place in Syria. And there has been a lot of immigration to our country, Turkey, because we are one of the neighbors of Syria. As NSO, we want to go to refugee camps and see their conditions, because there are people in need. They lose their families, they lose their jobs, they lose their houses. When we got there, we saw that they couldn't even find water to drink. They were trembling because of the cold weather. It was winter and children don't have even shoes. So when we're back, we know one thing for certain, that we're going to help them because we are Scots. We can't just ignore people who are in need. So as a first step, we organized some campaigns for Turkish Scots. We sent them tons of waters, clothes, human bases, but we know that we should find a long-term solution. Then we rented a 3-story building right behind the border in the city, Hatay. And we made there as our coordination center of search, rescue, and humanitarian aid institute of our federation. And our volunteer leader stayed there with 1 week period. And we established scout groups in every refugee camp and container city. Now we have more than 2,000 Scots in Syria, with Syrians. We also cooperated with the humanitarian aid operation, such as AFAD and Turkish Red Crescent. Our purpose is make them even just a 1 second smile, rehabilitate them through the scalp methods. But we learned that, we hear that the camp that we visited was bombed because terrorists, they go there and they kill all those innocent people and kids. So now I'm asking as a scout, if not us, who? If not now, when? We should do all we can do for people who are aggravated, who were suffered from obsessions. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Powerful message. Wonderful hard work our Scouts are doing in Turkey and around the world. I would now like to call on my brother from another mother, our last but not least, from the Sudan.
Hello, glad to be here and share my story among these amazing stories I'm sharing. I'm going to share the messengers of peace to Darfur. So, the Blue Nile State in Sudan, this state lies between, it lies in the borders between Sudan and South Sudan. So, refugees there fight, or they have a war against the army. Parents give birth to children, on average of 8, let them carry their weapons and fight against the army. So we, as scouts and messengers of peace, we've decided to go there and eliminate a solution for this. We've targeted children about from 11 years to 15 years to 16 years. We started the campaign there, and we've started with around 100 scouts. We targeted education. So we brought those scouts, those children, and let them join school. But the problem was that the nearest school to the camp was 10 kilometers away. Other schools was really like 20 kilometers away, and there's no any way of transport. So those kids was should go to school walking daily. And really in Sudan and in the Blue Nile State, we have very hot weather. So from here, the idea of the project came up. And the project is called the Peace Bicycles, or Bicycles of Peace. We started with 70 bicycles. We used 5 of them for the leaders, for the scout leaders. And we gave 65 for our best scouts. So we gave them the bicycles to go use it and go to school. We made something called the peer-to-peer education, in which every kid influenced his brother, his friend, to go to school or to come to scouting, other than to fight with weapons. So yes, everyone came. The camp was, we started was 100. After this, we became 1,200 scouts in the camp. Yes, we started the project, and it's really going, and it will continue. And we will go and educate more, because education is the most powerful weapon to create a better world. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Nabil. We are here to strengthen the network. We are here to strengthen the Messengers of Peace Initiative. And I would like to invite Daria to tell us about her project and how she's working hard to do that.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank you that I'm here, because for me it's something totally crazy. I want to start with something that I believe that every person who are here now at least once thought what exactly you can do to improve the world around you. And I asked myself this question as well, and I think I found my perfect place. In 2014, I visited a training about Messenger of Peace Initiative, and I was so inspired by this instrument, platform, bank of idea, bank of inspiration, and I decided that I have to involve as much people as I can. So when I came back and I saw that in my country just about 30 scouts are members in scout.org in this platform, I started to promote. I used every scout event, I spoke with every scout individually by Skype, I visited a few cities in Ukraine, I started to help, to share, to explain how to do this. I faced a lot of difficulties because access to internet in some places, villages in Ukraine, not so good. Knowledge of English. So I started to help individually each person to translate, to download, upload. And after I saw that also this is a perfect instrument to promote scouting between people who are not scouts. Because once one person asked me how I imagine my perfect world, and I thought that I think that it's like big scout jamboree. It's a place where all people share the same values, share the same kindness. And I started to promote Messenger of Peace and invite people to become scouts. And I saw that it works, maybe not so fast because I started this alone, but after more and more people joined me, and I believe that we are in our way, and I believe that we will create, we will invite more and more people to become scouts. And I want every person to do this. Let's create our perfect world together. Let's all people around be scouts and share the same values. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you to all of our heroes for sharing your inspiring stories, for having the chance to inspire others, for issuing clear and concrete calls to action. You are all heroes, and we are all scouts. Congratulations. I would now like to call on our guest speaker. We're very lucky to have with us a Malaysian woman who has started her own company. She is CEO of her own company. She is also co-founder of her own NGO. She works very hard at the community level to promote female and women's empowerment. And best of all, she is a scout. I would like to introduce Sarah Chen.
Heroes. I think I was just telling Shade earlier, I was looking for my scout scarf to really be part of this movement, but really, really proud to be here. And I was wondering, you know, I was thinking to myself, apart from the workshops that you've been through, apart from all the activities that you've done in the past couple of days, why are we all ultimately here? And it is because we're all here on the same value that we want to create a better world. And I asked myself this, how do we really create a better world? And are the movements like the Scouts, like Lean In, which I lead among 4,000 women here in Malaysia, 300,000 women across Asia, and globally we have 33,000 circles under Sheryl Sandberg, are we truly making a difference? And I came up with three key points which I want to share today, and also I'll welcome Q&A later, so I'll speak for about 15 minutes. Point number one. Question everything, culture and stereotypes. A big part of who we are today stems from our culture, a set of belief systems and a way of being. Globally, we are living and breathing a capitalistic culture, revolving around the idea of materialism, that everything revolves around profits. And the question of social impact has almost become a bad word. When I look at the work that we do in Lean In Malaysia, a platform where we educate, enable, and empower women into leadership, one of the biggest things we are fighting against is culture and stereotypes. At the core of how we work, it's systematically wrong. Long working hours, minimal flexibility. How are women supposed to succeed when the system itself works against us? Especially in Asian culture, where the truth is, and Lean In China, my counterparts in China actually did the study, the battleground for women is not only the workplace, but also at home. Our friend spoke about how he was criticized for fighting about women, for fighting about a real need of the basic feminine hygiene, but he was brave enough to be that outlier. See, until we change the way we think, until we change the way societies think, nothing is really going to change. Women in Malaysia and across the world, by the time you're 28, 29, girls like yourselves that have so much ambition in your eyes, they decide to drop out from the workforce. they decide to put a hold on their dreams because, of course, the family layer of responsibility does fall upon them. And whilst I'm encouraged that the world is changing and more men are leaning in, and all the men here today, as scouts, I read that diversity and inclusion is also one of your key points. Things are changing, but not enough. There's the gender wage gap, there is the lack of women in leadership. Today, reports on Forbes have said, oh, we've made great progress. But in fact, it's only 6.4% that are CEOs. I'm hoping all of you will be CEOs one day and leaders in your own right. But this is not going to happen until we change the way we think and we question the culture, the stereotypes that we are so ingrained upon. See, the second point I want to bring about is a key to what I think will start changing the game, which is develop great leaders. For the most part, you and I live in the world where creating or accessing platforms like the Scouts, using Skype, using technology, is a little bit better from when we had it in our parents' days. And therefore, I believe it is our responsibility not just to browse the internet and view that viral cat video over and over again, or that silly rooster in Malaysia that was a rooster that was running across the street and it had so much attention. I'm thinking to myself, we have so much more access to stories across the world that are making lives better, and we're not focusing on that. We are being distracted from the things that actually matter, from the work that all of you are doing. And I think it is our responsibility to take it upon ourselves to develop the world through ourselves, but also leading others around us. You know, I'll be honest, leading a women movement here in Malaysia, hell, it's difficult. I get criticized for being a feminist that's no longer relevant. You know, we all have equal rights. But yes, where are the women in leadership? 5% in Malaysia CEOs. You think they're in entrepreneurship? No, it's only 30% that are leading SMEs. Where are the women? The criticism of the Lean In movement is that we are leaning into the patriarchy, that we are advocating a certain model of a woman that will succeed. Like Sheryl Sandberg, the CEO of Facebook, she is privileged, she is educated, and therefore she's able to speak up and lean in. But what about the others? So you see, what happened in Norway is that they created a quota system back in 2006. They said, okay, let's get more diversity. Let's put 40% as a quota to get more board members that were women. And what happened was the golden skirts phenomenon, where the same kind of women, this lean-in model, where the woman was educated, privileged, the same names, were coming through the ranks. And therefore, it was not exactly truly a diverse model. So what then is the answer? So I think the answer lies in us, the leaders, to make a very conscious decision to address the bias that we have within ourselves as human beings. Are we listening only to the loudest voice? Is only the loudest voice the most important voice? I think not. Are there communities that are disadvantaged that don't have the access that we have? Of course. So think about that. It is our responsibility to think about those beyond our usual circles. The work that all of you are doing is truly inspiring to me, because you are going beyond the norm. And I believe that you are all not just good leaders, because good leaders, naturally, they develop people like them. You look like me, that's where the bros club happens, right? The same sort of people that have the connections and are able to make impacts. But let this not be the case. Be a great leader. Because a great leader doesn't only develop people like themselves, but develops everyone. Number three, dream big. You know, I have faced so many rejections in my life, and heck, I still do. I didn't come from a very rich background, couldn't afford to study law, but that was what I wanted to do in the UK. And I earned myself a scholarship after 30 rejections, because they said, I asked too many questions. I did not fit into the mold. I was too ambitious as a girl, and in fact, as a Malaysian, I couldn't compete globally. Well, I took it against my stride. I took that very personally, actually. It hurt me a lot, because it questioned the very basis of who I'm supposed to be as a woman, as a young girl growing up. But I picked myself up with good friends, with good family that encouraged me, and finally I did get that one scholarship. Somebody believed in me. So I work with Sime Darby right now that actually supported my education. I read law, graduated with honors in King's College London. I obtained an internship to work in two of my top cities in Chicago and London, and was elected recently to lead the Asia movement by Sheryl Sandberg herself for my work in Lean In. And every day I get to work with ambitious women on pursuing their choices, whatever that may be. See, whilst I don't have it to a perfect T yet, I am building the life that I want to compete globally, where I get to call both the US and Asia my home. And with that, I'd like to end with a very simple note. What is greatness? Greatness is not a quality of character, and it does not come from a position. Greatness comes from building a future together. Thank you.
First of all, thank you for everything you say. I'd like to ask you how studying law helped you to build your community and build yourself and achieve the thing that you want to change in your world.
Sorry, what was the question?
Studying law, how is that helping you? Yeah.
Ah, I see. Okay, so I think I'll speak of it from two perspectives, from my career perspective and of course from building the community. So my background is law and finance, and I always wanted to be active in investments. And because of my background in law, I was sort of picked out to be the pioneering team in a venture capital unit within Sime Darby, which is a company that I work for that also sponsored my education, which I'm extremely grateful for the opportunity. And I couldn't have been in that position without my background, because I think, sure, you can learn it along the way. You learn a lot of things on the job, but just having that stamp of credibility from a good university helped my boss pick me to do the work that I do. And in terms of leading my community, I think, you see, the truth is a university degree is a university degree. It's what you do while you're at university and what you do from there. And for me, I've always been, I think one of my key qualities that I'm proud of is I'm a people person. I just generally love people. And I have friends all across the world because of this. And in building your community, it's so important to harness this skill, because then, you know, I mean, honestly, I started literally with 500 ringgit. 500 ringgit is like $100. Me and my co-founder only had $100 to put into our nonprofit to hire a chief videographer. And we promoted it on Facebook and all that, right? But it was through the word of mouth, through friends that I made also, in the UK and university that are now all across the world in Silicon Valley and all that, that have helped me along the way, whether it's putting in a word for sponsors, whether it's putting in a word for a good speaker that we fly in to have an event, things like that. So I think every step goes a long way, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else in the queue so I can manage the time? Caitlin, please.
Thank you so much for coming to speak to us today. That was a wonderful speech. I was just wondering for some of the gentlemen in the room, what do you think the top things that men can do to support women are?
Very good question. So I think the guy from Mothers Against Girls, I think, did that brilliantly. You know, everyone put up your hand if you have a woman in your family, your mother, your sister, whatever. So I think this is definitely not an isolated issue that is a woman's issue, right? I hate it when people call it because it is a society issue. We are part of a society, and when you have half your population, 50% that holds half the sky, not contributing, you're not going to have a world that is progressive. So my advice for men in this room and those that are listening in is really to be an ally to your women community, to lead initiatives like this young gentleman out here, because he cares about it, right? At the end of the day, I don't think it's nice to say, you know, we need a help, but we need a partnership. We work hand in hand, whether that's in a support system, doing things at home to help out your mom or your sister or your mother or your wife, so that they can go out and pursue their dreams. That's going to change the game. I think also advocating in the workplace is very important. We have a lot of initiatives these days that are, to be honest, just lip service. So it's important for us, both men and women, who are part of the organization, to think about what it is that is really making a difference. How can we invest dollars into getting a more diverse workforce? Because at the end of the day, it's not just about women for women's sake. It is the diversity of opinion. When you have more opinions on the table, you make better decisions. That is the crux of the matter. So I would say support in any way you can. Think about your unconscious bias, even how you hire people, how you build your Boy Scouts community. Are they all people like you that just like you, to agree with you? Think about that. These things impact the way we work.
We have time for one more question. Hearing none, I want to thank Sarah again for her inspiring speech and spending time with us today. If you want to stay for the rest of the ceremony, you're more than welcome. Thank you, Sarah. Dear friends in scouting, I have great news. We've come to the moment of the ceremony that we've all been waiting for. We will make the presentation of the awards. I would like to now invite the Secretary General the World Organization of the Scout Movement, Mr. Ahmad Alandawi.
Let's start with giving the awards. How are you doing?
Good.
From the Kenyan Scout Association, Pauline. From the Ukraine, Daria. from Romania, Oana. Also from Mexico, Jessica.
All the stories and all the things you have done are very inspiring to us. And as you meet here in this this particular floor, and you're meeting with many of our colleagues, for our colleagues and myself, we are very, very proud of you. And we are very proud of what you represent to our movement today. So keep going and keep your incredible work. Keep spreading the work and don't be shy to talk about these things. Whether it's about supporting refugees or about gender equality or about any of the issues that you care about. Scouting is not a single issue movement. We care about wider range of issues. We care about what the communities care about. So that's why you need to continue doing this great work in your communities. So we're very proud of you. Congratulations. And congratulations to the previous one. I hope you're still going strong as well. And we hope Harold, you will join us while we see this thing. Hey! So, do you have any questions to any of them, of my colleagues or myself? Anything? Anything you'd like to ask about? Tell us. Take a second. Yeah. Caitlin.
When ideas. What do you think are some of the areas we're going to focus on?
Okay, it's a very good question. Yeah, first, you had the opportunity to learn about messengers of peace during this weekend, right? Now, messenger of peace is not only one initiative or one program, it's a movement as well that is carried by our movement. It's a movement that is talking about spreading the culture of peace and peace building and helping those in need. Now in the world today, you have the largest number of refugees since the Second World War. And there are so many great opportunities, but there are so many challenges and problems. As CALS are well positioned today to play a role in spreading the culture of peace and helping in the conciliation and in peace building. Our commitment to Messenger of Peace goes beyond only a singular program. It's basically manifested in everything we do. That's why Messenger of Peace and the peace building potential of scouting is enormous. And we have to continue building this work. I'm very committed to that. I'm very committed to continue supporting the work we started in all these communities. And the work we started over 780 million hours of service today and more. But also would like to celebrate the impact, not only the hours and the count. So would like to celebrate the great stories and the bravery of the people and the scouts that are doing in the camp. Now, one of the things that, you know, I left the United Nations as envoy, and there one of the last things I did there, something I'm very proud of, called a Security Council Resolution on Youth, Peace, and Security. I'm not sure how familiar you are with the UN, but if you are familiar with the UN, you know the most difficult thing to move at the UN is the Security Council. And it took us 3 years of work to get that resolution adopted. And that resolution is becoming now a movement worldwide. As chapters and even think tanks are writing about it, and there's so much funding coming in for it. And for me, that resolution 2250 on youth, peace, and security is about how young people around the world can contribute, not only as, because young people often are described by either as a problem or as victims, or as objects. Now we're talking about how young people around the world can play a role in being the agents of building peace. And I think what we do in scouting is exactly that. So that's why we have to go bigger and better, and we need to bring more attention to the work we do in peace building. The work you have done with the Syrian refugees is a reminder of the potential we have in supporting young people who are in need. And one of the things that will be taken care of in the next 3 years, we are now considering a program for scouting for refugees in a very institutionalized way. So we'll be able to extend more work and scouting work, non-formal education, to young people in emergencies. Because now we have seen a lot, and you see, for example, in Peru and other places, that we have a good humanitarian response as a relief effort after the floods or the earthquake in Mexico or in Sri Lanka and other places. But we also need to start looking at the educational part and how we can offer scouting for those who are dropping out of schools and they are not able to get any type of education. I think we can be a very good solution for that. Yeah? Good? Thank you. Thank you so much for being here, and I would like to acknowledge all the supporters of Messenger of Peace. I would like to acknowledge our brothers and sisters in Saudi Arabia for the amazing work. Dr. Hanna, thank you so much for being with us. And, thank you so much for the work. Thank you so much, and back to you.
If I could have all the heroes here, please. 2017 heroes.
You're tall. You're also tall. You're tall. That.
We're friends.
Okay, guys, try not to be a circle.
How?
Yeah,
can you
go into? Come
closer.
Say, Ellie! Look at me, look at me!
Smile!
Smile! They have a smile!
Yeah,
smile!
That's it!
Yeah.
Love you, Leo!
Please join us in the leisure for a reception outside.